I've been moving calm, don't start no trouble with me. Trying to keep it peaceful is a struggle for me. Don't pull up at 6 a.m. to cuddle with me. You know how I like it when you loving on me. I don't wanna die for them to miss me. Yes, I see the things that they wishing on me. Hope I got some brothers that outlive me. They gon' tell the story was different with me. God's plan. God's plan.
The Cure with Aimee Cabo. Life can bring many difficult situations, domestic violence, addictions, poverty, and even sexual abuse by your loved ones. Welcome, Aimee Cabo and The Cure.
Good afternoon and welcome to The Cure Radio Show. I'm your host, Aimee Cabo, with my amazing partner, Boris.
Wow, amazing.
Our show is available live on your radio, also live through our app, The Cure, on any smartphone, and our website, godisacure.com. We're broadcasting live from Miami through satellite, available on 35 radio stations among 11 states, and soon after the show, on any podcast player. This show deals with suffering and the tenacity of the human spirit, the will to survive, and the courage to keep moving forward, despite any obstacle, with the help of God and each other. We provide testimonials to let people know that we are not alone, as well as expert and inspirational speakers that can also help. In this show, the testimony started with me, having been a survivor from child abuse well into young adulthood. I do believe we're all suffering, and I hope to be a source of healing for each other. My cure was God, but other forms of healing are presented as well, to service everyone. Life can be very challenging, but always know there is always someone who cares. There is always hope. There is a peace beyond understanding that we feel whenever praying, as we know that God will never let us down, as He promises, this shall pass. The song we played earlier was God's Plan. By Drake. What is in God's plan? The world can be against us, yet a lot of us find comfort in knowing God's plan. And here are some examples in the KJV Bible. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. Jeremiah 29:11. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It is the gift of God. Ephesians 2:8-9. In God is my salvation and my glory. The rock of my strength and my refuge is in God. Psalm 62:7. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Psalm 121:3. The fear of man bringeth a snare, but whoso putteth his trust in the Lord shall be safe. Proverbs 29:25. He that handleth a matter wisely shall find good, and whoso trusteth in the Lord, happy is he. Proverbs 16:20. And Jesus said unto them, because of your unbelief, for verily I say unto you, if you have faith as a grain of a mustard seed, ye shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall be removed, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. Matthew 17:20. And lastly, whom have I in heaven but thee? And there is none upon earth that I desire beside thee. Psalm 73:25. Those are just a few examples. God plans the best for us and loves us dearly. Plans that provide grit, determination, and buoyancy. Such things I have only found evident in those that are faithful to God and follow His ways. God always has a plan for each one of us, even before the moment of conception, whether we are aware of it or not, and even when it's difficult to understand, though we can hold on to a sense of hope that can only be derived from faith in the bigger plan. Today, we have James Beverley, an associate director of the Institute for the Study of American Religion in Santa Barbara, California, and a professor at Tyndale Seminary in Toronto, Canada. He is a contributing editor to Christianity Today magazine and a frequent contributor to Faith Today and Charisma magazines. He has specialized for 20 years in the study of modern religious movements. He is the author of many books, including Holy Laughter and The Toronto Blessing. James, welcome to The Cure. You are now live.
Thanks, Aimee. Great to talk to you.
James, you have written about the effects of the virus and how it relates to religion amid unprecedented closures and conspiracy theories. What are your thoughts?
Well, we're in an amazing time in the world because of the virus. And
James, can you put your phone, the headphones to the phone, not on speaker?
You're sounding echoed. Sorry.
Oh, okay, hang on a second.
Sure.
Is that better?
Yes.
Okay, good. Well, Aimee, we're in an unprecedented time in the world because of the virus. And in America, that's compounded by the political division. So I'm glad that your website says that God is the cure, because we're learning more and more that you have to rest in Him because He's eternal. I love the Bible verses you started the show with. Wonderful passages. Anyway, I've been studying about Donald Trump and Christian views of him ever since he started to run for the presidency. And I don't know if you know it or not, but I came out with a book at the end of March that studies Trump in relation to Christian prophecy. So I've spent a long time, I spend almost every day thinking about American politics and Donald Trump and whether he's the right man for the job, and what's the proper view of him and American politics.
That's a very good thing to think about, because I sometimes wonder if we're headed towards socialism, straying away from Christians' beliefs and being misled. For example, just recently I discovered there's satanic churches. Is there an evil trying to get in God's way?
Well, thankfully, the satanic churches aren't very big, and there's not that many of them. I don't know if you know this or not, but many of the Satanists don't actually believe in Satan. That's mainly a gimmick to get attention. But be that as it may, it's sad that people want to say Hail Satan and be in the Church of Satan instead of following the Church of Jesus. You know, like you, I do worry about socialism. And if I had to choose right now about Election Day, I would be inclined to go with Donald Trump, because I'm worried about how radical the left wing is going. Also, I don't know if your audience knows this, but there's been more and more evidence that leading Democrats tried to overthrow Trump before he was elected, and even after he was elected, there was some machinations to really hurt his presidency. And of course, as you know, the American public is so divided now. Anybody who reads regularly about Trump from different perspectives would think there's two Donald Trumps. There's the one who's viewed as basically the incarnation of evil, who can do no right, and then there's the Trump of his fans who believe he's God's man for this time. The book I just wrote or came out at the end of March, I'll just show it on the camera here. It's called God's Man in the White House. And so charismatic and Pentecostal.
So that looks like
prophets.
Trump. Okay.
Oh, well, you know what? The picture is Donald Trump in the Oval Office. And a friend of mine, Rodney Howard Brown, was laying hands on him in a prayer time. Anyway, Rodney is a Pentecostal minister in Florida, and he gave me permission to put the picture on the cover of the book.
Wow.
So, as I was saying, there's like two Donald Trumps. There's the one who's viewed as a madman, and the other basically viewed as the cover of my book shows, he's God's man in the White House.
I
spend almost every day thinking about those options.
I definitely do think about those things too, with all the evil that I've been seeing lately, the mayhem, the cruelty, the destruction, the projection. Some have argued that these are the end of times, and just like they hated Jesus and they try to shut him out, could that be similar to what they're doing to Donald Trump, who still stands for Christian beliefs? And we will discuss that when we will return. We will continue talking to James Beverley about God's help with our great determination and buoyancy and the predictions we are yet to hear. Please stay with us.
We will be right back with Aimee Cabo and The Cure.
Not a yes sir, not a follower. Fit the box, fit the mold. Have a seat in the foyer. Take a number. I was lightning before the thunder.
Thunder, 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 thunder,
thunder, thunder, thunder, thunder, thunder,
thunder,
thunder, feel the thunder, lightning and the thunder, thunder. Feel the thunder, lightning and the thunder, 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 thunder.
Kids were laughing in my classes while I was scheming for the masses. Who do you think you are? Dreaming about being a big star.
And now we will continue with Aimee Cabo and The Cure.
Welcome back, and thanks for tuning in. Remember
that you can listen to the radio show live through our app The Cure with Aimee Cabo or later as a podcast. Why are you taking my lines?
The song that just played was Thunder by Imagine Dragons. This song first came out when I needed it most. I guess God is sweet like that. And music is an integral part of my daily routine and a source of strength. I wasn't a yes sir, never a follower, and soon discovered that I was lightning before I became thunder. Nobody would have guessed, and looks are deceiving. For once close to God, soon comes the thunder. I remember when the kids were laughing in my classes, until God and I said to the enemy, "Who do you think you are? Dreaming about being a big star? It seems basic. You seem easy," while he's riding in the back seat, until God takes the wheel. We are talking to James Beverley about determination with God's help to go through these hard times. James, our president, Donald Trump, came in as thunder. No one even saw the lightning. Surely God works in mysterious ways. Do you think he will stop what he started? Or will President Trump be reelected? Since you wrote God's Men in the White House.
Hello?
Okay. Yeah.
Yes.
Good. Thank you.
For the first time in a long while, the polls are showing that Biden's going to win. But I believe Trump thinks that this will be a repeat of 2016 where he pulls it off. I don't know if you know it or not, but in Vegas, they place odds on who's going to win, and up until recently they were giving it to Trump, but now it's shifted to Biden.
Oh.
I wouldn't want to bet on what's going to happen. Personally, I hope that Trump wins because I'm very worried about how radical the Democrats have become. You know, in this book I wrote about Trump, I say in the introduction that people should decide about who to vote for based on the principles and the issues.
So not the person. You're,
yeah. You know, I've used this example in my own personal life. Twice in my life, I've had open heart surgery. And both times, a world famous doctor in Toronto, where I've been a professor, both times the heart surgeon said, okay, you basically need surgery or you're going to die. You know, I happen to personally like the surgeon, but if I hadn't, I would have still gone for the surgery because the man who knew what he was doing in heart surgery knew what he was doing. So I know a lot of people don't like President Trump's style. They don't like some of his characteristics. But I think those have to give way to the principles about pro-life or about protecting the borders or about what's best for the economy. I've never met anyone who's pro-Trump who thinks that he's not without faults. Everybody knows that he can be too blunt sometimes or crude, et cetera, et cetera. But I think those issues have to take second place to the bigger issues about pro-life and about immigration and about securing the world in terms of, well, one thing I love about Trump is that he's not pushed America into wars. He's tried to get out of hot spots, etc.
Because he goes the peaceful way. Trump goes the peaceful way. And he also is guided by spiritual friends and also the Holy Spirit, I pray and hope. I know that a lot of people were pressuring him to react, to do something, but what did people want? Bloodshed? I think he made the right decisions. When did we expect ourselves to be perfect, or anyone in the matter in that matter? Nobody's perfect.
Right.
And when did we become irredeemable? That people cannot change their ways. That people cannot be better people. Where our pasts are being held against us. But you know what? This hatred and this vitriol that's coming towards Trump doesn't surprise me. Was Jesus not popular as well?
Right. Well, it's actually quite amazing that the president continues to do his work despite the unbelievable attacks on him. You know, every day I look at CNN or I read the Wall Street, the Washington Post and the New York Times. They attack him constantly, and it's often deeply unfair.
Well, isn't that also true when it comes to everyone in real life? The enemy is constantly attacking us, but God doesn't give us anything we can't handle. And Trump was perfect for that position because he was well prepared since birth. God had it in his plan. And so for
let me ask you, did you expect him to win in 2016?
I did not expect them to win, but I know that whatever happened would be God's will, and I was willing to accept that.
Right. Well, you know, one of the things I've done in my book is I've studied Christian prophets who believe that God told them, even as far back as 2015, that he was chosen by God. There's a guy in Florida named Jeremiah Johnson. He believes God told him in July of that year that God would use Trump. And then a bit later, a Dallas business guy named Lance Walno said that God told him to look to Isaiah 45. And then a bit later, an Australian woman named Lana Vouser, who wasn't that interested in politics, and hardly knew anything about Trump. She says God told her that Trump would be used to change the world. You can't, I mean, prophecy, charismatic prophets aren't infallible, so you got to be careful with that approach. But it's kind of unique that these people said Trump was going to win long before anybody was picking him as a possibility. You know, in December of 2015, the power leaders in the Republican Party, evangelical Christians, they basically chose Ted Cruz or Marco Rubio, and Donald Trump didn't even make their list. Hmm. So he's been a surprise. Oh, I was going to ask you, Aimee, maybe you could tell your viewers, do you wish Trump would change in any big ways that might help his chance of winning again?
No, I love him just the way he is. I think people should be true to themselves and change for no one, regardless of who they are or what they've done.
There you are. Mm-hmm. Do you think that the evangelicals still support him, though?
Oh, okay. Here's what you do. Evangelicals divide into two, basically. The majority of them, especially white evangelicals, love him. And then
let's continue after the break.
Like him so much.
We'll return with The Cure live every Saturday at 1 p.m. Stay with us. We would love to hear from you. Tell us your opinion. Call us 866-TRUTH.
34-TRUTH. 866-34-TRUTH.
That one.
Yes.
We will be right back with Aimee Cabo and The Cure.
Staring down the face of fear. Gotta keep breathing. When the negative is all you hear. Gotta keep believing. Cause in the dark there is a light. Truth that keeps on burning.
We will continue with Aimee Cabo and The Cure.
Welcome back, and thanks for tuning in. Remember, we're live every Saturday at 1 p.m. on your radio, on our app The Cure, and on our website, godisthecure.com.
Shows are available also as a video podcast or as an audio podcast. Just look for The Cure everywhere where podcasts are.
The song that just played was Warrior by Hannah Kerr. We always face our fears and keep moving forward despite all the negative we hear, because we continue believing that there is hope in the truth and its light burns bright. We are brave enough to fight the fight, and in our prayers we shout the battle cry. Faith is our shield, for God's love is the armor. So whenever we fall down, we only get stronger. We are talking to James Beverley about how to stay on the right path with God's help. James.
Nice to be back with you, Aimee.
Yes, and before we came into break, we were talking about the evangelical support. And I cannot say this for all religions, as I'm Catholic and sometimes I find myself disappointed. But let's speak about the evangelicals, since they've been true. Do you believe they're still supporting him?
The people who supported him in 2016, they're still with them. But there's always been evangelicals who don't like him, and they've gone against him. I don't know if you knew this, but in December last year, the editor of Christianity Today said Trump should be removed from office.
Oh, yeah, and you wrote an article about it.
Yeah, that's right. And I've actually done a book where I collected all the news reports and opinion pieces. So it created the biggest controversy in the magazine's history. It was the magazine was founded by Billy Graham, and this was the biggest controversy they ever had. The editor, Mark Galley, received death threats, and the opinions about his editorial were divided. Some people couldn't stand what he said. Billy Graham's son, Franklin Graham, wrote against him, as did Anne Graham, Billy Graham's daughter. But then two of Billy Graham's grandchildren supported the editorial. So the evangelical world has divided over Trump. And, you know, the divisions will continue until Election Day. And it's hard to know what would happen, what will happen if Trump wins again. Will the fighting still continue?
Well, that seems to be understandable, because I've never witnessed a more pro-faith president. I've seen him praying with others. When he held up the Bible, he showed us that he puts his pure faith in God. So tell us about hope, those things that produce grit, determination, and buoyancy. Some people seem unmoved by horrible circumstances and find joy nonetheless. What is the common denominator? Where does Trump's strength come from?
Well, I think that for every good he does, that comes from God. Like, he's been the most pro-Israel president in American history. That's why he's been honored by Israel, and he's been called by Israeli leaders the Cyrus of modern times, just like Cyrus of Persia rescued the Jews back in the days
King Cyrus,
of Babylon.
Right.
Yeah, so Trump is viewed as a Cyrus figure. You know, I this book that I did, God's Man in the White House, I did it with a friend. I did most of it, but a friend helped me on it, who's also the publisher, and he had an experience where he was praying one night, and he believes God told him to turn to Isaiah 45, and he didn't know what was in Isaiah 45, and he turned to it. And it's the passage about Cyrus, and he believes, like others, many others, Trump is a Cyrus figure to help Israel and help the Jews.
What's a Cyrus figure?
Pardon?
A king in troubled times, a Cyrus figure.
Cyrus was the king who helped the Jews get back to the Holy Land. 600 years before Jesus. So people view Trump as a Cyrus figure because he is so pro-Israel. So to get back to your question, I believe that everything good that Donald Trump does is from God. And, obviously his weaknesses and failures are not from God. And what we all hope for, except his enemies, but any decent person will hope that he grows as the president. And if he wins a second term, people should hope that he deals with the virus correctly and gets the economy strong again. But he faces enormous opposition.
Well,
the level of hate against him is astounding.
I think we know the enormous opposition that he faces, but we're also impressed by his determination, his optimism. He sees the bright side no matter what, and that's a common denominator that I've seen in most people. I even had in my show somebody who was being tortured at the moment, but he thought it was an honor to be tortured next to sweet Jesus. These people seem like invisible. They have faith that's unbroken. They're unmovable. And I think that the common denominator between all these people surviving, you know, just horrible odds and horrible circumstances is God's promises, is God's plan, It's this, it's their right. faith that they have in him. It's that they yeah. know that he's not changing and his promises are true.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, if you don't mind, I'd love to tell your radio audience about a book sale. My publisher agreed that if people order three of my books, they get them at 30% off. So one of them is the book I showed earlier, God's Man in the White House. I also wrote a book called Mormon Crisis, and it's about, obviously, Mormonism. And then I've written a book on Islam called Getting Jesus Right. Anyway, the book on Mormonism, Islam, and then the one on Donald Trump are available at 30% off. And for people to get the deal, they have to go, they can go to my website, jamesbeverley.com, and they can see the details. And if they order all three, they get free shipping. They can also order the books on Amazon.
And that will all be on my website also. I'll explain in the end. I didn't know there was a Mormon crisis. Is there a Mormon crisis?
Oh, yeah. The Mormon church is hurting really bad. The numbers are falling. And it's mainly rooted in Mormons finding out that their leader, Joseph Smith, was not a very moral character. And so as those discoveries have been made and the evidence is clear, that's led a lot of Mormons to leave the Mormon church.
Yes, but you find that in every religion. There's priests that are not good either. You know, pickpocket, he's everywhere. You don't even know he's stealing your soul.
Yeah, let me tell you the difference, Aimee.
Yes,
just
sure.
Just let me tell you the difference there. Yes, every religion has bad people in it. No doubt about it. Every non-religion has bad people in it. Here's the trouble with the Mormon case. Joseph Smith is the leader. He's basically the founder of the Mormon church. And so discovering that he committed adultery on his wife, that he abused women, that he broke the law, those realities have really affected Mormonism. The parallel would be if we found out that Jesus was a criminal or that he was immoral, that would be the parallel. Mormons should keep their faith in God and they should keep their faith in Jesus, but there's been a crisis over the Joseph Smith who is the man.
There's a crisis everywhere, and we all sin. Nobody's not guilty. I mean, look at the celebrities. It appears that there's no religion there. Look about when Kanye West openly and strongly showed his faith, he received so much hate. So,
I know.
But you know what? I focus on the good. I focus on the good
people.
Oh,
that's good. Well, listen,
I focus on hope, and that's what we're going to talk about next. We would love to hear from you. Tell us your opinion about what's going on in the world. 866-34-TRUTH.
We will be right back with Aimee Cabo and The Cure.
Remember those walls I built? Baby, they're tumbling down. And they didn't even put up a fight. They didn't even make a sound. I found a way to let you in, but I never really had a doubt. Standing in the light of your halo, I got my angel now. It's like I've been awakened. Every rule I had you breaking. It's the risk that I'm taking. Yeah.
now we will continue with Aimee Cabo and The Cure.
Hi again, and thanks for tuning in. We are live every Saturday at 1 p.m. on your radio, our app The Cure, and on social media. Just look for God is a Cure. That song that just played was Halo by Buoyancy. All the years gradually built up endless walls that were easily tumbled down without putting up much of a fight, hardly even heard a sound. I found a way to truly let God in, though I never really had a doubt. And now I see all the halos and so many more angels now. It's like I've been awakened, no longer having every rule breaking. And yes, it's a harder route, but it's the risk I'm willing to take. Never again will I shut God out, for He's my saving grace. He is everything we need and more. We are surrounded by His embrace. This halo won't fade away.
Was this the music that somebody suggested and he won $25?
Yes, we have a winner. This was a song that was suggested by Michelle, our little daughter.
There you are. There's sure you didn't like have extra special attention there? Okay, anyway, we have a caller in with a comment. Let's see. Mary Ellen, can we hear your comment? You're now live.
Yes, I'm 60 years old. I was raised in Salt Lake City, Utah. Born and raised a very, very staunch Mormon. My comment is that the gentleman, the author that just spoke with you, his last comment that I want you to know now that I am a born-again Christian. I'll praise Jesus. I love Him so much.
Nice.
It's so good to be free, but my comment is...
Welcome back.
thank you. You cut him off when he was trying to say that they're being led by a liar and a thief. Joseph Smith, the point that I'm trying to make is, yes, you said yes, but there's bad things in everyone, and we should do, or in all religions, and we should just try to look at the good. And well, all the Mormons that was raised around me, my teachers and people around me in my church, they were wonderful to me. The Mormon people are so incredibly awesome. It's the doctrine is so wrong, and the people out there, the Mormons, they believe that it's true because they want to keep their families forever in eternity.
Right. Let's
James Common.
Okay.
You know, I'm glad you pointed out that the Mormons you grew up with are wonderful people. There's no doubt at all that Mormons generally are wonderful people. And they're much better than their leader, Joseph Smith. I don't know if Amy's ever studied Joseph Smith's life, but he was the kind of guy who would write a mother and say, he would marry a mother and a daughter and keep it secret from his wife.
Wow.
Thank you. That is true. That's why I didn't want that man to be cut off.
Oh, goodness gracious. No,
he came back. Look at that.
We had to go to a break. So, I like Aimee saying we need to accent the good. And I'm glad you came on and said that Mormons are basically wonderful people. But they, sadly, Joseph Smith got away from the basic gospel. He taught salvation by works. He denied the Trinity. He believed that there's more than one God.
And so
sometimes religions get so far away from the truth that you have to pay attention to that fact without being too nasty.
You know, from the time I was a little girl, and I was always such a good child, but I never felt good enough. And I had such a... It's like God spoke to me when I was a little tiny girl. I'm talking like 6 years old. I knew I would never become a goddess. I knew my husband would never be a god. I knew as that young that it was, that part was wrong. But as far as the people, they were great. It's the doctrine and people out there. That's what we need to tell the Mormons love them, and
hey, you know, but that's shocking that I should hear this, but it doesn't surprise me. I've seen a lot of religions, especially the leaders, go astray. And, you know, unfortunately, that's where evil wants to attack the most, where it's going to influence the most people, where it's going to discourage people away.
Yeah, that's why it says in the Bible that teachers will be judged with greater strictness, because they have an enormous responsibility. By the way, I'd love to tell you, I've studied religions for around 50 years. I've been a professor for 41. Anyway, here's three tips to help your audience. When you think about what path to follow, you got to guard three things. Guard your mind. Don't join any group that won't let you think and study. Guard your body, because some leaders will abuse you physically, sexually. So guard your mind, guard your body, and then some leaders only want your money. And they so you need to guard your wallet or your purse as well. I've spent my life studying cult groups and big religions, and you're right, every religion can be bad, but those three tips will help people. So guard your mind, guard your wallet, and guard your body.
And here's my tip, pray as much as possible. Just pray, pray, because those negative thoughts will come in and those bad feelings will come in. And the best way to combat that, even if you're confused and you don't know what's the right thing to do, pray. God does answer those prayers.
Yep, absolutely.
And if I can ask you, because we're coming to the end of the show and I'm very interested in this. Tell me about modern-day miracles or apparitions, physical manifestations, in the next 2 minutes.
Okay. I love studying that topic. And what you have to do is, if you hear something that's amazing, you don't automatically believe it, because some people are liars. So go check it out. And I believe, based on, you know, I'm now 66 years old, so I've heard a lot of stories and investigated, and I believe that God does miracles. He does healings. He speaks to people.
Okay, more specifically, tell me about holy laughter.
In the Toronto. Okay.
What is this holy laughter? I was curious.
Yeah, it's a reality that happened in 1994. The Toronto Vineyard Church became the center of an international revival. And it was famous because of laughter in the meetings. And the man who took the picture on the cover of my book about Trump, he's the guy who got famous for starting Holy Laughter. He's a revivalist. He lives in Florida now, but he's from South Africa. And people started falling over, laughing in his meetings. So that was the start of Holy Laughter. Now listen, some people just laugh in the crowd because everybody else is doing it. But I did a lot of investigation, and there's some people who went to meetings. They said things like, I'll never laugh, I'll never fall down, I won't get slain in the spirit. And lo and behold, it happened to them. So I think God does strange things, and you just have to check them out and, you know, keep your head up and be careful. Don't believe everything that you hear, but test the spirits, the Bible says.
Nice.
Well, I believe what I feel, and it's holy joy.
Oh, good. But yeah, Aimee, we've not met, but you seem like a really happy person.
Thanks to God. He's so good to me. But good. We've come to an end of the show. Sorry. It was such a great pleasure,
fine.
James, to have you on the show. And guys, you can read more about James on guess what? JamesBeverley.com. That makes sense. And so,
thanks, Aimee.
Thank you. And like we always do, we'll finish with a prayer. It's always good to do that. It's always so good. But this one's about determination. Oh Lord, help us to be on guard so that we can stand firm in our faith. We know that standing firm requires us to be determined and motivated. So, Lord, we pray for your help in this area of our life. We also pray that throughout our trials, we remain courageous and strong, because you are always with us, and you will never leave us. Lord, we love you with all our heart, and we thank you for giving us the victory that we will receive. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Lord, you're an amazing God. You move mountains. Nothing is impossible for you. Sometimes I live in fear and worry too often. I fail to trust in you. Empower me to seek you in prayer. Believe that you are more than all I need, but also give me determination to be diligent in the tasks set before me. Amen. Thanks to Robbie Dillmore of Kingdom Pursuit and the Christian Car Guy for his continuing guidance. Check out his shows. They're more than awesome, extremely inspiring, and the Christian Car Guy. For his continuing guidance, check out his shows. They're more than awesome, extremely inspiring, and informative. This is Aimee Cabo. You have been listening to The Cure.
Please check out our podcast, The Cure with Aimee Cabo, our app, The Cure, or our website, GodIsTheCure.com. Please also subscribe to the podcast so you don't miss an episode. And please rate it.
Thank you to our listeners, and thank you for being with us. Until next week, much love and peace.
The show is every Saturday at 1 p.m.
Thank you for listening to The Cure with Aimee Cabo.